More than 4 billion people live across Asia. And we are telling their stories. In this edition, we travel to South Korea, where a large number of young people today are fighting an inner battle in the shadows, often all by themselves. The term hikikomori was coined in Japan in the 1990s to describe this phenomenon of social withdrawal. Today, many municipal governments in South Korea are using incentives to try to help those who suffer from hikikomori come out of the shadows, reintegrate back into society, and hopefully live a fuller life. In rural Pakistan, one woman has done the seemingly impossible, defying the odds of poverty and a lack of resources that were stacked against her. She has become a highly respected teacher, gaining global recognition for her work. Join us as we meet this incredible teacher who is empowering her students in Pakistan and helping them to become global citizens.
In South Korea, where the neon lights never dim, there exists a dark and growing reality known as hikikomori, a term coined in neighboring Japan in the 90s to describe severe social withdrawal among the nation's youth. It involves a complete split from the outside world, even from close friends.
이제 나중에는 진짜 완전히 네, 연락을 다 끊고 진짜 거의 집안에서만 네, 지냈던 것 같아요. 한 7개월 정도 그렇게 지냈던 것 같아요. 주로 이제 방에서 맨날 자고 뭐 컴퓨터 하고 게임하고 그러다가 너무 방 안에만 있으니까 좀 심심하더라고요. 그래서 이제 밖에 나가서 뭔가 운동을 하고 싶은데 사람 많을 때는 또 아예 그러면서 약간
사회가 저를 고립시키진 않았고요. 저 같은 경우에는 개인적인 사유인데 강박장애와 우울증이 심하다고 병원에서 진단받아서 그 이후로 제가 고립 운동 생활을 길게 보냈습니다.
Meet Yong Hwanbin and Chang Sung-jun, two souls formerly lost in the shadows of their own minds. Once hoping to become a judge, Chang Sung-jun found himself ensnared by disappointment after failing his exams. Becoming a recluse was not difficult in the internet age, where entertainment and even food delivery is just a click away.
아마 못했을 것 같아요. 네. 그 거의 대부분의 시간을 컴퓨터 하면서 보냈던 것 같아서 그게 없었으면은 힘들지 않았을까요? 네. 아, 뭐 이렇게 물건이 많지는 않고 그냥 침대에 있고 그 맞은편에 책상이랑 컴퓨터 있어서 약간 누워서도 볼 수 있게 약간 돼 있고 그리고 이제 옆에 뭐 옷장이나 책장 그런 거에서 공부하던 책들을 쌓여 있고 약간 거의 그 정도 거의 대부분 그냥 누워 있었던 것 같아요. 그냥 누워서 보다가 잠깐 일어나서 컴퓨터 하다가 또 누워 있고 막 누워 있는 시간이 엄청 많았던 것 같아요. 식사도 이제 가족들이랑 이제 같이 먹는 게 좀 불편해서 약간 좀 혼자 따로 먹었던 것 같아요. 네.
Yong Hwanbin spent 8 years in isolation and remains in a process of transition.
아직까지 제가 강박장애와 우울증으로 제가 치료를 받고 있기 때문에 아직은 시기가 이르다고 생각합니다.
Like others, his desire to leave confinement is being helped by organizations funded by the Seoul Metropolitan Government. These groups have so far helped more than 550 people to embark on a journey of rediscovery. Through vocational training and community support, they are slowly reclaiming their lives, one step at a time.
여러분이 올해 보여주신 그런 변화의 모습들이 내년도 계획을 더 알차게 세워서 보다 많은 터널을 지나고 있는 우리 청년들이 밝은 세상으로 나와서 함께 우리와 어우러질 수 있는 그런 세상이 될 수 있는데 바탕이 되어주지 않을까 그런 기대를 가지고 오는 것을 생각했습니다.
Despite the success stories, the number of people
choosing seclusion still far outweigh those who are returning to the light. Another complicating factor is there are many reasons why a growing number of Koreans are choosing self-isolation.
어떤 사람은 뭐 학교 폭력, 어떤 사람은 가정의 어떤 어려움, 어떤 사람은 친구 관계, 어떤 사람은 이성의 문제, 뭐 어떤 사람 학업의 문제, 이런 다양한 문제가 있지만 그거에 따라서 이제 여러 가지 얼마나 중복되고 있느냐에 따라서 그 은둔의 길이와 또 고립의 또 강도가 달라집니다. 그래서 회복하는 데에도 사실 그만큼 거의 두 배 이상 걸리는 것 같아요. 자신이 5년 동안 고립되어 은둔 생활을 했다면 회복하는 데에는 거의 10년이 걸린다고 생각이 되어져요.
고립 은둔 청년은 이례적인 상황이나 갑자기 발생한 것이 아니고요. 오랫동안 누적되어 온 개인적인 심리적 표현 현상입니다. 그래서 그것을 병리학적으로 보기보다는 그 원인에 대해서 청소년기, 아동기부터 그 청년들의 삶을 돌아봐줘야 되고 그 이후에는 자기 이해, 그다음에 자가 진단, 그리고 전문가의 손길을 통해서 원인을 규명하고 원인을 해소하고 그다음에 단계적으로 회복할 수 있는 프로그램을 체계적으로 마련해 주는 것이 가장 필요합니다.
That helping hand begins with regaining mental and physical health through face-to-face interaction with other hikikomori.
청년들이 바로 사회에 진입하면 좋겠지만 사회에 진입하기 어려워하는 청년들을 위해서 그거에 대한 경험, 그러니까 일에 대한 사전적인 경험들을 시켜주는 일들을 지금 주력으로 하고 있습니다.
신체적인 부분, 정서적인 부분, 또 관계적인 부분, 그리고 지적인 부분까지 채워질 수 있도록 1년 동안 이 네 가지를 중심으로 해서 프로그램을 배치했고 거기에서 육체적인 건강을 좀 깨우면 정서적으로 환기가 되는 것을 경험할 수 있는데 그래서 저희는 야구를 하게 되고 이 안에서 요가를 하게 되고 그리고 같이 밥을 먹고 그래서 같이 밥을 먹는 것도 굉장히 중요하고요. 또 요즘에는 1인 가구가 굉장히 많고 또 1인 고독사도 많이 이슈화가 되고 있고
South Korea's Institute for Health and Social Affairs estimates about 3% of people aged 19 to 39 are considered lonely or isolated. Many live in the capital, Seoul.
작년도 저희 실태 조사를 통해서는 저희 서울시에 있는 청년의 규모는 약 280명인데 고립 있는 청년은 약 13만 명에 달한다고 추정을 하고 있습니다. 꽤 많은 상황이고요.
South Korea's highly competitive culture can easily lead to a sense of failure. Compounded by the harsh judgment, the same culture often delivers to those who stop striving.
처음에는 게으른 사람들, 그다음에 실패한 사람들에 대한 인식이 굉장히 컸어요. 근데 그분들을 직접 만나다 보니까 이분들이 조그만 도움의 손길로 벗어날 수 있는 것들을 알게 됐거든요. 근데 그 지원에 있어서는 심리 상담이나 심리적인 문제나 그다음에 경제적인 문제나 취업에 대한 알선 등 다양한 좀 지원책이 필요하고요. 이분들이 꼭 게으르고 그다음에 나태하고 그런 분들이 아니라는 거를 꼭 말씀드리고 싶습니다.
Attitudes are quickly changing as awareness on the issue grows. The South Korean government is also now offering cash incentives and subsidies for services including health, education and counseling. But experts say it's organizations like SEEDS and Blue Whale that will remain vital for success. And success will be critical for South Korea already battling the world's lowest fertility rate and declining productivity.
스스로 그런 상황에서 환경에서 나오기 굉장히 힘들기 때문에 타인이나 아니면은 단체나 기관에서 그 사람을 발굴해 나가는 과정이 중요하다고 생각합니다. 저는 고립 운동 생활을 굉장히 오래 했기 때문에 이제 저같이 고립 운동 생활을 길게 한 사람들을 돕기 위해서 사회복지사 공부를 내년부터 할 계획에 있고요.
Young Hwanbin is also moving on with a new life.
지금은 이제 동부기술교육원에서 디저트 브런치과라고 제과 제빵을 배우고 있는데요. 지금 자격증 하나는 취득한 상태고 나머지 두 개는 결과를 기다리고 있는 상황인데 그거를 딴다고 해서 막 취업이 되고 그러진 않더라고요. 그래서 그쪽으로 취업도 알아보면서 뭐 다른 일반 기업 취업도 지금 알아보고 있는 상황입니다. 사실 저는 이제 올해 너무 큰 도움을 받았다고 생각하고 정말 감사하고 있고요. 이런 게 좀 진작 있었으면은 더 좋지 않았을까 그런 생각을 하는 사람이라서 그런 관심에 너무 감사하고 앞으로 많은 청년들에게 도움이 됐으면 합니다.
For these Koreans and countless others like them, the journey out of darkness remains fraught with challenges. But with government support and the unwavering dedication of support organizations, they are rewriting their stories and turning the shadows into stepping stones towards a brighter tomorrow. Jack Barton for Assignment Asia in South Korea.
Up next, we explore the remarkable story of Rifat Arif and find out how this dedicated teacher is bringing hope to students in rural Pakistan. Yet her journey has been anything but easy.
This is Gujranwala, a city in the northeastern Punjab province of Pakistan. In the rustic villages that surround the city, where dreams often surrender to tradition, one woman dared to defy societal norms and ignited an educational revolution. Born as Rifat Arif in 1984 in the heart of Gujranwala, a tale of relentless spirit brewing beneath the surface. In 2023, she was elected from over 7,000 nominations from 130 countries as the winner of the largest annual global prize for teachers, the Varkey Foundation Global Teacher Prize of $1 million. Arif has become an inspiration and a light of hope, providing education and empowering hundreds of Pakistani women. But her journey has not been easy. Growing up, Rifat was a spirited young girl, like any other teenager, full of mischief and dreams. Despite societal pressures, she refused to conform, harboring a burning desire to break free from the constraints placed upon her. She was a bright student who had a desire to learn new things as well as a love of books. As a student, she loved asking questions, but one fateful day, a traumatic event shattered Rifat's dreams. The humiliation she endured at the hands of her teacher became the catalyst for a radical decision that would change the course of her life.
If we begin from 1997, when I started my journey, I was 13 years old. One incident happened in my school. The behavior of my teacher was not good.
Rifat vowed never to return, scarred by a system that failed to nurture the innocence of childhood.
I believe the leaders are born. You can polish them. You cannot produce them. Even now, when some people ask me, what inspired you? Who inspired you? Who was your ideal? Why did you decide to become a teacher? It's difficult for me to answer this thing because there was nothing around me to inspire. Because as you can see, I belong to a village. I belong to a working class. My parents are not well educated, and there was no one around me very well educated. But I decided to make a school, my own school.
Undeterred by societal skepticism, Rifat Arif embarked on a journey of self-study, determined to provide education with love and respect. Her open-air classroom became a symbol of hope and dedication. Without wasting any time, she started teaching herself, her younger sister and her younger sister's friends in her courtyard. Flyers were distributed in the neighborhood announcing free education for girls.
Everybody has challenges. Everybody has to face difficulties. Everybody has to face the circumstances that can push them back. But the leaders, the dreamers, they have to push the challenges back and have to move forward. The challenges are the beauty of our life. If there are no challenges, then there is no meaning of success. So if you want to be successful in your life, feel blessed when you have challenges, because every challenge is going to teach you something. Every challenge is going to show you another way to grow in your mission and to get closer to your goal.
Rifat passed the 10th grade examination as a private candidate. As more girls kept joining the group, a school started taking shape.
This is something interesting, because in the beginning, as you know, I was just 13 years old. People thought she's just a child and she will leave it after a few days. She's just playing and that's all. They didn't take it serious. Also, I left my school in 7th standard. I was not enough educated to be a teacher, so nobody took me serious. But then, just after 2 or 3 months, I had 20 students in my classroom. And why I was getting students? Because I encouraged them to ask me questions. And when they started asking me questions, I started looking for the answers. So there were many different ways I was using to answer the questions. So it was something interesting for them, because they were getting knowledge and they were knowing something that they have never known before. When the students started coming to me, it gave me more courage and confidence to carry on, because I did not feel alone. And then after a few months, I realized I did not have financial resources. So how could I buy things, the pencils and the notebooks for the students? And how could I carry on my free school? So I started working as a child laborer. Within 2 or 3 years, I was able to make people realize and to understand and to accept that she is able to do something and we should trust her. But if you talk about the challenges, as time passed by, the challenges were increasing.
For a brief period, she also worked as a receptionist at a telecom franchise. But what she earned was not enough to support her school, and the hours were long. Rifat eventually started using her embroidery skills that she had picked up along the way in order to generate an income and have enough time for her school.
I was doing embroidery on the shirts, and I would get 10 rupees for one shirt. And I have always been working until 2017, 8 hours a day, and I would teach 4 hours a day in my school, and I would teach myself 4 hours a day.
The girls were now studying in a rented open roof house with financial support from Rifat, who had now adopted the name Sister Zef. Her mission, to spread education to every corner of the world.
मैं जब मैट्रिक तक तो मैं स्कूल में पढ़ी हूँ तो वहाँ पे वही वो घिसा पटा स्टाइल रट्टे लगाए एंड मार कुटाई डांटना सेल्फ रिस्पेक्ट को मजबूर करना ये सारा कुछ बहुत ज़्यादा था पर जब मैं यहाँ आई इनके पास मैंने पढ़ना स्टार्ट किया इन्होंने हमें एक अलग लेवल की रिस्पेक्ट दी थी यहाँ पे हम अपने आप को ये समझते थे कि हम कुछ हैं इन्होंने हमारे अंदर की सलाहियत को निकाला हमसे फिर मैं एक चीज़ मुझे बड़ी मज़े की लगती थी यहाँ पे ना जो बहुत ज़्यादा अंडर प्रिविलेज बच्चे यहाँ पे आते थे हमारे स्कूल में तो उनके लिए हम इस तरह की चीज़ें ऑर्गेनाइज करते थे किसी ज़्यादा हमें कहते थे कि इनके घर में फ़ूड पूरी नहीं मिलती इनको और वो अपनी सैलरी में से हमारी ही ड्यूटीज़ होती थी हम बच्चों के लिए बॉयल एग जो होते हैं उनका अरेंज करते थे उनके लिए दूध स्पेशल लगवाया होता था जो बच्चे घरों में बिल्कुल खुराक जिनको नहीं पूरी मिलती थी हम उनको वो भी देते थे हम उनको पढ़ाते भी थे
Balancing work, education, and her altruistic mission, Rifat faced numerous challenges. Yet her determination led her to achieve academic milestones independently, without the support of formal institutions.
In 2014, when I won Lynn Sims Global Prize, I was given 20,000 USDs. So I bought this land where we are sitting at the moment, and I made this vocational center. Why I made this vocational center is because I know when women are empowered, their children are empowered. They have an access to education, they can have good diet, and they can have a hope for a brighter future. So I made this vocational center, and I not only started giving vocational training to women, the mothers, but also the young women who complete their 10 years of education from my school, so that they can start earning and they can pursue their higher education. They can pay their college and university fee and can get higher education.
The winner of the 2023 Global Teacher Prize is Sister Zef from Pakistan.
Rifat Arif's unwavering commitment to education and empowerment earned her global recognition. From prestigious awards to becoming the first woman among Pakistani minorities to graduate from the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue, her journey is marked by milestones. Rifat's impact extends beyond the classroom. A World Pulse ambassador, an alumna of the Swedish Institute, and a member of the Network for Religious and Traditional Peacemakers. She's a global force for positive change.
I had nothing when I started my journey. And now I have reached the level where I can dream that I can make an impact all over the world. I can make an impact on the educational policies of not only the policies of my own country, but all over the world.
Rifat Arif's thirst for knowledge knows no bounds. From civic and citizenship education to nature-based solutions, for disaster and climate resilience, she's a lifelong learner, constantly enriching herself for the betterment of others.
Today's generation, their life is going to be very difficult because they have to face so many challenges that previous generations never thought of. Climate change, natural disaster, the planet is facing the challenge of overpopulation, inflation, conflicts. The new generation, they have to face all these challenges, and they should be equipped enough with knowledge, expertise, and skills to tackle with these challenges. Our life, the people of my age or the previous generation, their life was difficult, but their challenges were different. Now, our next generations are going to face much more challenges. And I have proved throughout my journey of 26 years that I am aware of those challenges, and I am giving awareness and skills and knowledge to my students, even in a village.
Rifat Arif's remarkable achievements have earned her a place among the notable women of Pakistan, standing tall alongside former Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto. Today, Rifat Arif's journey continues as she pioneers the ZEF Institute of Brainy Women, empowering countless lives through education and skill development. Her story, a tribute to the belief that education has the power to transform lives. Her vision.
Since my childhood, I have a dream to make this school for 2,000 students in 10 acres, where my students will grow their own food and they will learn all kinds of skills. And teachers from all over the world will come and teach these students. Why I want teachers from all over the world to come and stay in my school and teach the students? Because I know, and you know, that we are living in a global village now. And we have to teach our next generation to be global citizens. The citizens who have acceptance for everyone. The students who have tolerance to listen to others, to give them an opportunity to have their say to give their opinion and who do not want to speak only. They have the ability to respect all the cultures, all the religions, and they can fit in everywhere, wherever they go in the world.
Follow us on social media to contribute story ideas and share your thoughts.